The joy of the Lord will be my strength. I will not falter, I will not faint. He is my shepherd, I am not afraid. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord will be my strength. He will uphold me all of my days. I am surrounded by mercy and grace. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord will be my strength. I will not waver walking by faith. He will be strong to deliver me safe. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Oh yes, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Pray with me, please. Heavenly Father, thank you for all that call Lakehoma home. Thank you for each one here this morning and those watching online, that we may worship you, encourage each other, grow closer in our walk with you. We pray that you will provide healing and comfort to our church families that need it, and be with the leadership here, the decisions they make for your church. Lord, I confess that it is easy to be distracted with all that is going on in this country and the world around us. My prayer is that we will not suppress the spirit within us, but feed it through your word and with prayer, so that we aren't absorbed into earthly distractions. Instead, may we set our minds and hearts on things above. It is comforting to know that you are in control. We don't have to do it alone, because you are with us. You have shown your amazing love for us by giving us your Son. He's the author of our salvation. And because of this, we're your adopted sons and daughters through Christ Jesus. Be with James in the lesson that he brings to us. Speak to us through your word, that we may hear your guidance for our lives. Father, strengthen our faith. Give us confidence in your word, so that we may be your light to those around us. And may we remember your power to save us through Christ our Savior. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah. The book of Revelation isn't one we visit often, at least willingly. It's full of monsters and dragons, apocalyptic horsemen, bowls of God's wrath, all these signs and wonders that can instill fear in us because we don't know exactly what they mean. It's easy to project our worst ideas, our worst fears on something unknown. That's something many of us have been feeling recently. And maybe the few glimpses of hope you have, whether you're gathered here in the church building, or whether you're finally going back to work, you feel the oppression starting to lift. But you wonder if it will stay. You wonder if things haven't been changed. You wonder if things ever will change for the better. And whether that oppression that some have felt for a long time will finally lift off their shoulders. But I've got a secret for Revelation, a secret that unlocks the whole book. It was right there the whole time. Chapter 1, verse 8. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. That's right there at the beginning of Revelation. And then at the end, in the last chapter, 22, verses 12 and 13. Behold, I'm coming soon, God says again. My reward is with me, and I will give it to everyone according to what he and she has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Revelation is bookended by this secret, just as our lives are bookended by that same secret. God is in control. He was there in the beginning, and he'll be there in the end. Where we are right now is just the middle. It's hard to see God sometimes. It's hard to see his hand at work. It's hard to look through all of the dragons, all of the monsters, all of the seals being broken and pouring out his wrath, and to see that there is a light at the end, just as there was a light at the beginning. Some of you are still taking communion at home. Maybe with your small group of family, or maybe by yourself, as you have been for what feels like forever now. And those of you even gathered here in our building, you're not that physically close. We're not passing trays. Things are still different. Things still feel confusing, because things are still unknown. But I've got a secret. God is in control. We may be in the middle, but God is first and God is last. As we take this cup and as we eat this bread, we remember Jesus and the sacrifice he gave to us. He sacrificed his body 2,000 years ago, gave his blood for the forgiveness of our sins. And in the future, he's coming back to redeem us, to save us. And each week we take this cup, we take this bread to remember him, to remind ourselves that we're just in the middle. We can't predict the future, but I can predict that God is in control. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this time that we can meet with others digitally, with others 6 feet apart, but that we can meet each week. We thank you for your Son, for the blood he shed, for the death that he died, that we could be forgiven of our sins. I pray our hearts are focused on you during communion, and that our minds focus on your Son and the sacrifice he gave for us. I pray we live this week serving you, live this week praising you, and we live this week loving others, no matter what. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Let's pray. God, as we take this cup as a symbol of the blood that your Son shed, I pray again that we let it wash ourselves clean of our sin, and that you see not us, not our sins, not our faults, but that you see your Son in all his perfection. I pray that we remember that perfection, and that we live as one that has been saved. Live as one that wants to follow your Son and live as he did. In his name we pray. Amen.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory.
Good morning. I want to begin with a question this morning. Why is it that we are often so unkind to our spouse, to our children, to our siblings, to our parents, than we are to total strangers? I can't believe it, but that's so true, isn't it? I know it is in my life. I mean, there are times when I've said things to Deborah and said things to my children. The moment I said them, I wish I could take them back. And I know you know what that means, because most everybody has said something that's unkind. And I think about those times I've done that. I wouldn't have said that to a total stranger. I would have never said it to any of you. But why are we not merciful even to our own family? Why are we not forgiving to our own children and our parents? We're looking at the Beatitude, blessed are those who are merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Now, we've talked about four before, and these are kind of the conditions of the sow. And remember, this is kingdom language, okay? Kingdom language. God's inviting us into his kingdom, and he's asking those to come into his kingdom. And he says, if you're going to come into my kingdom, there is kingdom that's going to rule. Kingdom language that's going to rule. And you're going to need to listen to that kingdom language and be a part of that kingdom now, because the kingdom of heaven is here on earth as it is in heaven, as he talks about in his prayer in Matthew chapter 6. And so when we think about that, the kingdom of heaven here, let's bring the kingdom of God that's there, let's bring that here, let's act like that and be like that. So the condition of the sow that we've looked at is, blessed are those who are poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the land or the earth. And blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be satisfied, or they shall be filled. These are conditions of one's soul. These are how people were on the side of that mountain. And Jesus is inviting people who have those conditions of the soul to actually be a part of his kingdom. Now he looks at the fruit of the soul. And the fruit of the soul, the first fruit of the soul, is blessed are those who are merciful. Here's your fruit. Are you a merciful person? Because I want people in my kingdom who are merciful individuals. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy from me. I need God's mercy. There is no way for me to be in God's kingdom without his mercy and his grace. No way for me to do that. And yet I don't think we fully understand what mercy means, because, man, when I look at what's going on in social media today, even from our brothers and sisters in Christ, the language that's used, the hatred that's used, it's unbecoming of what brothers and sisters, how we ought to respond. But I know, hey, I've got my opinion. I just want to put it out there. I'm just going to make sure I get my statement in. I'm just going to make sure I get this so that everybody else can understand exactly where I am and how it's supposed to be. We're at a time in our lives right now when Christians ought to be rising up and showing people mercy and forgiving them. But it seems like we've gone the opposite way. We've got all these things that are happening, and it's not bringing out the best in us, it's bringing out the worst in us. Why in the world is that? When it comes to masks and wearing masks, it brings out the worst in us. I mean, when Walmart this past week said, hey, listen, everybody's going to have to wear a mask. Do you wear a seatbelt? To protect yourself? I'm not going to get off on that, okay? But there are other things. I know our young people did a whole week on racism at their camp, which they had here at the building. And it was about, how can I step into the shoes of another and understand what's going on in a black person's life? How can I show them mercy? How can I understand them? And again, the social media and our language that's out there right now, what's going on in our hearts, it hurts me to see it. It hurts me to see it. I'm worried. I'm worried that what Jesus wants from us and what he wants from his church is not what's happening. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. So exactly what is mercy? Exactly what is mercy? Mercy is compassion for those who are afflicted. It's compassion for those who are afflicted. It's a desire to relieve that affliction. In other words, compassion plus action equals that mercy. Compassion plus action equals mercy. Just because I say it and say, I'm a merciful person, it requires action. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are those who are compassionate and showing action toward others. In other words, I must put myself in the shoes of other people, the shoes of my spouse, the shoes of my siblings, the shoes of my children, to understand them, to understand them. And I put myself in their shoes so that I can understand where they're coming from, so that I might forgive them. Forgive them. People, if we don't understand this, if we don't get this in our lives, I'm concerned about people's souls. And as one who loves you, who cares deeply for you, I want all of you to have the hope of heaven one day. I do. We hear the term, I've got to walk a mile. Mercy is basically walking a mile in another person's shoes. And if I don't put myself in there, then I don't know exactly how to live. Let me give you the opposite of this from Scripture, okay? So instead of a blessing, let me give you the cursed side. Cursed are those who show partiality and are biased toward others, for they shall be judged without mercy. That's the other side of this. Here's the blessing, but here's the cursed side of that. Because understand, that's kind of what Deuteronomy talks about. Here's your blessings. Here's your curses. Here's your blessings. Here's the curses. Here's what will happen to you if you do those things that are right, and you will be blessed. But here's those things that are happening to you if you don't do those things that are right, and you will be cursed. So on every side of these Beatitudes, there's a blessing, but there's also this curse that comes. Cursed are those who show partiality and are biased toward others, for they shall be judged without mercy. Now look at James chapter 2, verse 13, and it says this: for judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. That's what James says. For judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy, because mercy triumphs over judgment. When I forgive, when I consider, when I see someone's life and I walk in their shoes before I make any judgment at all, when I try to understand that other person and where they're coming from, even my spouse, I'm so grateful for a loving and compassionate wife. Because there are so many times when I've been unmerciful to her. You ever done that? You ever said some things that you know you shouldn't have said? Yeah. Done it on more than one occasion. More than one occasion. And I'm grateful for someone who is merciful and who shows compassion and who is forgiving. And the reason she can be like that, and the reason I'm supposed to be like that, the reason we're all supposed to be like that, is because God did this for us. God did this for us. God was showed us mercy. When we were far away, He came to be with us. See, Jesus put Himself in our shoes. You can't say what Jesus did was anything else but putting Himself in our shoes so that He could understand us. So that as one who is tempted, he could understand how we have been tempted, because He has been tempted in all points but without sin. And people, with the measure that we use, it will be measured back to us. That's what Jesus says too in Luke chapter 6. With the measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. So yes, I'm concerned. I'm concerned with the language that's happening today. I'm concerned with the divisiveness that's occurring. I'm just concerned about the way we are treating even our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. I've got an opinion. I've got an opinion. Let's go beat heads against each other. Is that what God wants us to do? We're to live in love. We're to show mercy. Why? Because God showed us mercy. When we were still sinners, so far away, He brought us near. Man, I wish I had time to read Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. If you have time, read that whole thing. It's great. But let me give you this passage here, which says this. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love which He has for us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. Okay, so here's the positive side of mercy. The positive side is that we have a God who is gracious. We have a God who is compassionate. We have a God who is forgiving. We have a God who has overlooked, who looks at us and loves us so much that He wants to bring us near. When we were so far away from Him, He wants to bring us near to Him. And the way He did that is through His Son. And His Son comes down and He says, live a life of mercy. Live a life of mercy, because you will receive mercy on that day. On that day, when we stand before Him, I will need His mercy. I will need His grace. And that comes through the blood of Jesus Christ, which continually cleanses me from all sin. But I'm going to bow at the throne of grace. I will drop to my knees, because I am not worthy. I'm not. And none of us are. But it's amazing to me how it's much easier to put people down. It's much easier to recognize everybody's flaws, except our own. It's much easier to be arrogant toward others. Here's what mercy is. Mercy is hospitality loved out, not lived out, but loved out. Mercy is forgiveness loved out. Mercy is compassion loved out. On your discussion guides for your small groups, if you're not meeting and you'd like one of those small group discussion guides, just email me and I'll be more than happy to give one to you. But in that discussion guide, I ask everybody to to actually go to Luke chapter 10 and read the story of the Good Samaritan. Because that is mercy loved out. That's compassion loved out. That's hospitality loved out. We have been loved out by God, and we're supposed to love other people. Love and show mercy and compassion and be forgiving. If you really fulfill the royal law according to Scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You are doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. This is important. This is very important. And in this time, like I said before, like in this time, we need to be at our best and not at our worst. People, this is an act of worship to God. I want to read Romans chapter 12, verse 1. It says this, I appeal to you, therefore, by the mercies of God, by God's mercy, by the mercies of God, I appeal to you to present your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable, which is your spiritual worship. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to present your bodies as living sacrifices by the mercies of God. Since He has been merciful to us, we need to be merciful to others. In our spiritual act of worship, our spiritual act of worship is being merciful to others. That's a part of our spiritual act of worship. Because you're going down from there in Romans chapter 12, and he says so many things. Just let me give you a few characteristics of mercy. These are the fruit of one's souls. Let your love be genuine. Bless those who persecute you. Live in harmony with one another. Repay no one evil for evil. Never avenge yourselves. Overcome evil with good. Why? Again, because of Jesus. Because Jesus was merciful. And because He is merciful, we need to be merciful. Because He stepped in other people's shoes, our shoes, my shoes, your shoes, He knows exactly what's going on in your heart. He understands that, and He's calling us to something. He's calling us to be a merciful person. He understands the temptation we have to write something and the anger we get when we look at something and we go, oh, I want people to understand this way. And we have these opinions and this thought, and we just throw it out there. Just throw it out there for everybody to see. Jesus understands. He gave up His rights to come down to heaven. You know, and I'm going to say something, and I'm not ashamed of it. I think many times we put more faith in the Declaration of Independence than we do in Scripture. Now, I know that's hard to say, but it's true. We put more faith in what the Declaration of Independence says in our Constitution than we do in what Jesus tells us how to live. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Verse 17, for God did not come to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. God didn't come to condemn the world. He came to save the world. And that way that we, as brothers and sisters, save this world is not with the anger, not with the animosity, not with the bias that we have. We save the world by being Jesus, by showing Jesus to others. Will you be Jesus? Will you walk in his steps, in his shoes? He walked in ours. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. May God bless you, and may his power and his spirit be within you.